Welcome back to Deep Learning. Today we want to continue talking about our common practices, and the methods that we are interested in today is class imbalance.
Machines don't really have common sense now.
So a very typical problem is that one class in particular, the very interesting one, is not very frequent. So this is a challenge for all the machine learning algorithms, because let's take the example of fraud detection. Out of 10,000 transactions, 9,999 are genuine and only one is fraudulent. So if you classify everything as genuine,
also because I'm lazy,
you get 99.99% accuracy. Obviously, if you had a model that would misclassify one out of 100 transactions, then you would end up only in a model with 99% accuracy. So this is, of course, a very hard problem. And in particular, in screening applications, you have to be very careful, because just classifying everything to the most common class would still get you very, very good accuracies.
Machine learning is the science of sloppiness.
It doesn't have to be credit cards. For example, here, detecting mitotic cells is a very similar problem. So a mitosis is a cell undergoing cell division, and they are very important, as we already heard in the introduction, because if you count the cells under mitosis, you know how aggressively this cancer is growing. So this is a very important feature, but you have to detect them correctly. And they make up only a very small portion of the cells and tissues. So the data of this class is seen much less during the training, and measures like the L2 norm or cross entropy don't show this imbalance. So they are not very responsive to this. One thing that you can do, for example, is resampling. So the idea is that you balance the class frequencies by sampling classes differently. So you can undersample. This means that you have to throw away a lot of the training data of the most frequent classes. And this way you get to train a classifier that will be balanced towards both of these classes.
The stuff that works best is really simple.
Now they're seen approximately as frequent as the other class. Now, the disadvantage of this approach is that you're not using all the data that is being seen. Yeah? And of course, you don't want to throw away data.
We have 99% of all the data.
So another technique is oversampling, and you can just sample more often from the underrepresented classes. And in this case, you can use all of the data. Well, the disadvantage is, of course, that it can lead to rather heavy overfitting towards the less frequently seen examples. Also possible are combinations of under and oversampling. This then leads to the following procedure. This is an advanced resampling technique to try to avoid the shortcomings of over and undersampling by synthetic minority oversampling techniques mode, but it's rather uncommon in deep learning. Underfitting caused by undersampling can be reduced by taking a different subset after each epoch, which is quite common. And also you can use data augmentation to help reducing overfitting for underrepresented classes. So you essentially augment more of the samples that you have seen less frequently. Very typical choice.
We are happy that it works better than any competing method, but that doesn't mean that we think we are done.
So instead of fixing the data, of course, you can also try to adapt the loss function to be stable with respect to class imbalance. And here you then choose a loss with the inverse class frequency. So you can then create the weighted cross entropy, where you introduce this additional weight, WK. And WK is simply determined as the inverse class frequency. More common in segmentation problems are then things like a dice-based loss based on the dice coefficient. That is a very typical measure for evaluating segmentations. Instead of class frequency, weights can also be adapted with regards to other considerations, but we are not discussing them here in this current lecture.
What is clear to me is that engineers and companies and labs And grad students will continue to tune architectures and explore all kinds of tweaks to make the current state of the art ever slightly better. But I don't think that's going to be nearly enough.
This already brings us to the end of this part. And in the final lecture of Common Practices, we will now discuss measures of evaluation and how to evaluate our models appropriately. So thank you very much for listening, and goodbye.